us this evening is a very famous essay by the very celebrated French humanist Michel de Montaigne, who wrote an essay called On Cannibals towards the end of the 16th century. Like many of his essays, this was an essay that he revised several times. And after providing a description of cannibalism in the New World, in Brazil, he writes the following sentence. I am not sorry that we notice the barbarous horror of such acts, but I am heartily sorry that judging their faults rightly, we should be so blind to our own. I think there is no more barbarity in eating a man alive than in eating him dead. I'm sorry, I think there is more barbarity in eating a man alive than in eating him dead. And in tearing by tortures and the rack a body still full of feeling, in roasting a man bit by bit, in having him bitten and mangled by dogs and swine, than in roasting him and eating him after he is dead. In this passage, as elsewhere in the essays, Montaigne invited his readers not to be too quick to judge what might appear to be the barbarity of another culture. His voice might strike us, and here I think we would be right to hear it this way, as a voice of tolerance. Certainly Montaigne's writing was motivated largely by his horror at the wars of religion, which were raging in France in precisely the years in which he was writing the essays. We also know that he was one of the first Europeans to write in a very clear way against the use of torture. And his knowledge of ancient literature played a role in helping him understand that social customs vary. But he also read widely in modern literature. He avidly read reports that described in increasingly textured detail the cultures of China and South Asia. He was also fascinated by reports he read of the New World. This evening, I'll be particularly interested in the question, particularly engaged in the question of how Europeans in Montaigne's generation viewed the newly discovered peoples of Europe, of America. Not surprisingly, many thinkers in England, Holland, France, Spain, and Portugal, and elsewhere, were convinced of their cultural superiority as they heard about the peoples of the Americas. In their minds, Europeans represented civilization. The peoples of the New World, by contrast, stood for savagery or barbarity. And on this spectrum, reports of cannibalism among various peoples in the New World served to emphasize their extreme, brutal savagery and barbarity. Yet, as we shall see, there were currents in European thought that called this hierarchy into question. And it was upon these currents that Montaigne would draw in critiquing the smug claims to superiority of his fellow Christians in the second half of the 16th century. It is well known that in this encounter, the European representation of the natives of the New World as cannibals was part of a process of marking, or at least marking many of the peoples of the New World as other, and not only as different, but as inferior to Europeans. Throughout Western literature, from Herodotus and Pliny, through Marco Polo and Mandeville, the image of other peoples as man-eaters, as eaters of human flesh, had played a prominent role in othering peoples in this fashion. And it should not be surprising that many European explorers and missionaries, upon their encounter with the peoples of the New World, first in the Caribbean and later in Central America and Brazil, would have transposed this idea of the anthropophagus to the Americas. Indeed, so strong was this tendency that in the 1970s, William Ahrens, an American anthropologist, argued in his book, The Man-Eating Myth, that the European accounts of cannibalism in the New World do not prove that there were cannibalistic practices at all in the Americas. And while Ahrens did not absolutely exclude the possibility that cannibalism did exist, he made it quite clear that the practice of cannibalism was extremely doubtful, and that in the end, cannibalism was neither a practice of the Caribs, nor of the Tupinamba, nor of the Aztecs, but rather an operational representation of the Europeans that gave the Spanish and the Portuguese, and later the French, the Dutch, and the English, license to slaughter, enslave, conquer, and colonize the Indians of the Americas in the 16th, 17th, and 18th centuries. I have no doubt that many early modern European writings about the New World did serve the interests of colonizing powers of Spain, Portugal, France, Holland, and England. I should say here, I'm quite astonished, because this topic is quite new to me, at the large number of such reports that come to Europe in the 16th, 17th, and 18th century. They're flooding into Europe, and the printing press is spreading them through European capitals and bringing them to the attention of European literate classes. But not all the writings produced about the New World in this period were imperialistic. Many of Montaigne's contemporaries struggled to make sense of the customs of the New World. And it's towards these efforts of trying to make sense of these customs that I want to gesture today and to try to understand a bit what was the context, the intellectual framework within which at least some Europeans in this period were thinking much more seriously about the material than simply providing a kind of caricature of certain ritual behaviors that could be operationalized and create these binaries of Christian, cannibal, or civilized barbaric in this period. When Montaigne gave his essay the title on cannibals, the cannibal in French, he was first and foremost making use of a modern word. Montaigne would have known of anthropophagi, or man-eaters, from his readings of ancient authors, from Herodotus, or Pliny especially, who wrote of certain tribes of the Scythians which feed upon human flesh. But his interest, Montaigne's interest, was really modern, not ancient. When he was writing at the end of the 16th century, the word cannibal itself was of relatively recent coinage. It was Columbus, shown here in Stradonis' famous book of recent discoveries, producing these plates at the end of the 16th century. It was Columbus who had created the word to describe certain peoples of the Caribbean, who he learned from his enemy, their enemies, the Arawaks, were eaters of human flesh. So we want to pause for a minute and watch Columbus try to make sense of this new reality. His journals here are absolutely fascinating. I'm going to have to read this because it's somewhat intricate. Columbus's fashioning of the term cannibal from Caribs, the enemies of the Arawaks, and this is, I think, extremely important. The Arawaks are Taínos of the Caribbean, and they inhabit essentially the northern islands, and the Caribs inhabit the islands further to the south in the Caribbean. And Columbus is originally among the Arawaks. And when he talks to them about the Caribs, and he's never seen on his first voyage to the New World, it's from them, supposedly, that he learns they eat human flesh. So let's follow Columbus in his journal. Now, this is his journal. It's a little bit problematic because his original journal doesn't survive. This is a copy of his journal by the famous Spanish writer Bartolomé de las Casas, who wrote against the Spanish imperialists in the New World in another very important venue. But he preserves the journal. Columbus's first allusion to man-eating natives comes within a month of his arrival in the Caribbean. He arrives there in October 1492. As his entry of November 4th, 1492 reads, "I also understand that a long distance from here, there are men with one eye and others with dog snouts." And here, by the way, he's picking up on ancient and medieval representations from writers like Pliny about imaginary antiquities, people who live outside the swath of civilization, who eat men. "On taking a man, they behead him and drink his blood and cut off his genitals." Just a lapidary comment on the one-eyed, dog-eared, man-eating Caribs. Then on November 23rd, he gives these alleged man-eaters, who were also in Columbus's imagination, one-eyed and dog-eared, the name cannibals. as he writes, the Arawaks, the Indians of the islands he's first encountering, in their description of one of the islands inhabited by the Caribs, say it is very large and has people there with one eye on the forehead, as well as others they call cannibals, of whom they show great fear. When they saw I was taking that course, they were too afraid to talk. They say that the cannibals eat people and are well armed. Now, Caraba or Caniba was this Taino or Arawak word for the inhabitants of these southern islands. Columbus invents the word cannibal from Caraba. It's remarkable to watch him express doubts, though, about the real existence of the phenomenon he names but never sees. The Indians with whom, he writes in his entry of November 26, continued to show great fear because of the course I was taking and kept insisting that the Caribs had only one eye on the face of a dog, and they fear being eaten. I do not believe any of this. I feel that the Indians they fear belong to the domain of the Great Khan. Of course, Columbus believes he's in Asia. On December 17th, he's even more dismissive. The Canada, he writes, are none other than the people of the Great Khan, who must be very near here. They have ships that come to these lands to capture these people and take them away. Since the people never return, it is believed they have been eaten. By the way, this belief that the people in ships who take them away were cannibals was projected onto European slavers in West Africa. We know that Africans who stayed behind and saw their fellow Africans captured believed they were being taken off to be consumed by the Europeans. So Europeans were, in the early modern imagination of much of West Africa, also cannibals. The Indians showed us two men who had lost some chunks of flesh from their bodies and said that the cannibals had bitten up the pieces. I do not believe this. This is Columbus saying, who invents the word cannibal, saying he doubts their cannibals. Yet, within another month, he returns to his belief in the man-eating Caribs. They must be very daring people, since they go to all the islands and eat the people that they capture. Without doubt, the people, the Caribs here, are evil, and I believe they're from the island of Carib, and that they eat men. Ultimately, it's this final view of Columbus, namely that the Caribs are man-eaters, that will go public. In his famous letter to Luis de San Angel, which he writes on his voyage back to Spain, Columbus writes, "Thus I have found no monsters, nor had any report of any, except in an island, Carib, which is the second at the coming into the Indies, and which is inhabited by people who are regarded in the island as very fierce and who eat human flesh." This letter would circulate immediately throughout much of Europe, appearing first in Spanish in Barcelona and later in Latin in Rome, with further Latin editions in Antwerp, Basel, and Paris. But it is Columbus's letter of 1494 about his second voyage, a text that will find even wider circulation, that is responsible for the introduction of the word cannibal into Western languages. Columbus writes, "But it's amongst these islands, those inhabited by the cannibals are the largest and most populous. I have thought it expedient to send to Spain men and women from the islands which they inhabit in the hope that they may one day be led to abandon their barbarous custom of eating their fellow creatures." So he links the idea of cannibal to flesh eating, and this is the first text we have that circulates in Europe that uses the word cannibal. It's remarkable how quickly this word takes root and begins to circulate in accounts of the New World. We find inhabitants, or certain inhabitants of the New World, characterized as man-eaters in some of the very first texts that circulate on the Americas. And one of the most famous is by the Florentine Amerigo Vespucci, who travels to the coast of Brazil and who, in his experience, spends time among people that he will describe as eaters of human flesh. He writes in his Mundus Novus, his New World of 1503, a very important text that will influence people like Thomas More in writing his Utopia. He writes that among these inhabitants, there are people who eat little flesh unless it be human flesh. And your magnificence must know that they are so inhumane as to transgress regarding this most bestial custom. For they eat all their enemies they kill or take. females as well as males, with so much barbarity that it is a brutal thing to mention. How much more to see it, as happened to me an infinite number of times. They were astonished at us when we told them that we did not eat our enemies. Your magnificent make-believe for certain that they have many other barbarous customs. And he goes on to describe in some detail what he sees as the customs and barbarism of the peoples in the New World. The Italian scholar Pietro Mortire d'Anghera would draw on reports of sailors and merchants and others in his De Orbe Novo, his work on the New World of 1510. And he also writes of these man-eaters and cannibals contributing to the widespread view among Europeans that the inhabitants of the New World were cannibals, the lowest form of barbarians, savages, in short, to the fashioning of the myth of primitivism and barbarity that would play an important role in legitimating the conquest of the New World by the old. But this discovery, or this imagined discovery, of this aspect of the New World did not only lead to the forging of a colonialist imagination, it also contributed in a decisive way to what historians of ideas have called to a crisis of skepticism in early modern Europe. The very fact that Europeans in this period had discovered a continent about which neither scripture nor the text of the ancients showed any knowledge proved extremely disorienting to European intellectuals in this period. Throughout the Middle Ages and into and throughout most of the Renaissance, knowledge was based on grappling with ancient texts. It's quite the opposite of our idea of knowledge today. We believe the most recent book on a subject is the most definitive book on the subject. That would have been unimaginable in this period. In this period, the most authoritative texts were texts written by God, written down by Moses or dictated by Moses, or texts written by writers like Plato or Aristotle. This is where wisdom lay. And to suddenly learn that that wisdom did not incorporate an aspect of the world and made no sense of that aspect of the world creates this question, what do we after all know? If Plato didn't know, if Aristotle didn't know, if scripture doesn't know, what is it that we can know? And this crisis of skepticism would be felt greatly in Europe, even early on in Europe in the 16th century. And writers like Erasmus of Rotterdam or Guicciardini, a great Florentine scholar, acknowledged that these challenges were raised by the discovery of the New World. And then just to use a local example, in a lecture delivered to his students at the University of Padua in 1538, the great Renaissance philosopher Pietro Pomponazzi shared with his students the contents of a letter he had recently received from a Venetian friend. The friend, in all likelihood, Antonio Pigafetta, who had been part of Magellan's famous effort to circumnavigate the Earth. Magellan doesn't make it, but his crew does, and Pigafetta does, had in Pomponazzi's accounting of the letter accompanied the papal nuncio to the King of Spain, and finding himself there, was sent on an expedition sent by the king. He went to the southern hemisphere, and now he writes to me that having passed the Pillars of Hercules, the Strait of Gibraltar, they have sailed in the southern hemisphere for nearly 3 months and come across more than 300 islands, each separate from the next, which were not only inhabitable, but which were inhabited. These arguments prove that Aristotle and the ancients had been wrong. They had argued that the torrid zone could not be inhabited, but it was inhabited. And the question Pomponazzi raises is, if we don't know the truth about this, what truths do we in fact know? So he's really foreshadowing this development of skepticism that will play such an important role in the 16th and 17th and even 18th centuries. By the late 16th century, when Montaigne was writing his essay on cannibals, there was now a large body of text about the New World. Many of these talk about the experience of the French in Brazil. Montaigne learns about the Brazilian experience from published texts. But Montaigne in his essays often stretches the truth a bit and uses literary conceits to make his point. So at the beginning of his essay, rather than saying, I'm drawing on these French authors, he writes the following. I long had a man in my house that lived 10 or 12 years in the New World, discovered in these latter days and in that part of it where Villegagnon landed. He's referring here to Brazil. The French developed a colony in Brazil in the 1550s, and he's saying that he had someone from this colony live with him. That's very unlikely. He also says that he's heard about it from several seamen and merchants who were at the time on the same voyage. Not entirely impossible. Montaigne had close connections to the city of Bordeaux. He'd been mayor of the city of Bordeaux. He had grown up in the city of Bordeaux. His family had been merchants there. He certainly would have known the quay. He would have known the ships coming back. But he really is drawing on two texts. And these two texts that he's drawing on were one by the Catholic missionary and royal cosmographer André Thévet, and the other by a French Huguenot, Jean de Léry, both of which were published at the end of the 16th century, and both of which influenced Montaigne's account. Now, Thévet, the Franciscan Thévet, had sailed with the Admiral Villegagnon from France to Brazil in 1555. He spent slightly over a year there as chaplain to the fledgling French colony at Fort Coligny before coming back to France in 1557, where later that same year he published his same account of his experiences in the New World. Then in March of 1557, only a few months after Thévet's departure, Jean de Lévy, but this is his book, Histoire d'un voyage, fait en terre Brésil, History of a Voyage Made into the Land of Brazil. Jean de Lévy arrived in Brazil as part of the first Protestant mission to the Americas. Just 23 at the time, de Lévy was as eager for his venture as for helping to establish the Reformed faith abroad. In November 1556, he embarked for France on one of the three warships the King Henry II had financed in order to bolster the fledgling colony on the island in Guanabara Bay. I don't have a good slide for Guanabara Bay, but Guanabara Bay is the bay upon which Rio de Janeiro looks out today. And the French, who were trying to oppose Portuguese expansion in Brazil, established in 1555 a colony, and their colony is Fort Coligny. It's also called France Antarctique in the 1550s. And it's to this colony that Thévet goes as the chaplain to Villegagnon, and it's to this colony that he goes as a young member of the Reformed faith. When he arrives in this colony, he finds the conditions primitive. There's only one timber structure and a few scattered grass roof huts. The goal was to counter Portugal's dominance of trade with Brazil. But there was also an effort on the part of certain highly placed French courtiers to try to establish a Huguenot colony in Brazil. So there's this mixture, it's the most amazing story, there's this mixture of Huguenots and Catholics on this island in Guanabara Bay in the 1550s. And actually, one can make a case that the French wars of religion, because there's violence between the Catholics and the Protestants on this island, that the French wars of religion don't break out in France, they break out in Brazil, which is astonishing. But there was this extraordinary conflict over the Eucharist in this time period. Even though the Protestants were first welcomed on the island, Villegagnon, who was their commander and the chief of this fort, suddenly turns against them. Ostensibly, he became enraged, Villegagnon. By the way, I should say, Villegagnon had fought the Turks. He was a knight of Malta. He was an arch-Catholic. Why he actually called for Protestants to come to the island. Why exactly, we're not certain. He grows very distressed after he witnesses the Huguenot Last Supper, where rather than the belief in the real presence, he argues that One is simply commemorating the sacrifice of Christ. And Ville-Gagnon denounces the Catholics for the rejection of this doctrine of transubstantiation. We think his theological argument was a pretext. We don't really know. He must have believed he would receive greater support and unanimity on the island if there were only Catholics on the island, and he wants to rid the island of the Calvinists. In October of that year, several of the Calvinists, for their safety, flee to the mainland, and they live for several months among the Tupinamba, a group of Tupi Indians, a particular group of Tupi Indians. And it's on the basis of his experience living among the Tupinamba while seeking refuge from this vicious French captain that Delarue accumulates his information about the Tupinamba customs. And it's important to know that he was actually there among them. Now, cannibalism plays a salient role in both Tevez and Delarue's published accounts of their experiences in the New Worlds. But it's important to say immediately that it is not their central concern. One of the most impressive aspects of the works is that both Tevez and Delarue offer what we might describe as a social explanation of the practices they observe, an explanation that Montaigne himself will largely adopt in his essay on this scene. Essentially, both Tevez and Delarue present cannibalism as the ritual core of the vendetta, or the feud. That is, they explain the behavior of the Tupinamba in reference to what their contemporary readers would have recognized as a central structure in the feudal organization of Europe in the 16th century. The perennial threat of violence between noble clans, who well into the early modern period, as several historians have shown, used the feud as a mechanism both to preserve their power and to maintain peace. Tevez actually specifically calls the conflict vengeance, vendetta, underlying in his chapter this thirst among the Tupinamba for vengeance as a trigger that his European noble readers would have recognized to be something quite like the vengeance or the desire for vendetta among feudal clans in Europe. The particular feud that Tevez and Delarue described was one that pitted the Tupinamba and the Tupiniquin, two of the major tribes of the Tupi Guarani peoples, against one another. This is not a map that really explains that precisely. This is a contemporary map. You'll see cannibals mentioned just to the north of France Antarctique. The Tupiniquin were slightly more southern, and these two groups had a great deal of warfare against each other in the 16th century. Were they belligerent in a particular way? No, they were allied, the southern group by the Portuguese, the northern group by the French, so they were made more belligerent by European conquest in this time period, and it's this that aggravates the tensions between the two groups. We would say that the feud as a structure in European society, although it sounds horrible, actually serves to keep the peace. It's the threat of violence that keeps the peace in the feud. And it's very likely that the threat of violence keeps the peace among the peoples in the New World as well. In this period, with the interference of the peoples from the Old World and their colonial efforts to gain access to resources in Brazil, the violence is increasing. And both Tevez and Delarue witness the warfare of these two groups. They argue that it's in this context that cannibalism takes place. The goal of the conflict, for the military conflicts, was not to kill as many as of one's enemy on the battlefield as possible, but to take a significant number of them captive. And it was these captives who would become ritually sacrificed and eaten by the victors. Tevez and Delarue each devote several pages to describing the various stages of ritual. The prisoners, they say, are treated surprisingly well. They are given wives. They are fed, but fed to be fattened. And then they are executed in a ceremony in which both they and their captors declare their valor. It's by no means clear that Tevez or Delarue viewed this behavior as essentially worse than the behaviors they had witnessed in France in the 16th century. This is particularly true of Delarue. Tevez is a bit more ambiguous. This was, after all, in France in this period, a moment in which there was a breakdown of the public order because of the wars of religion. It's a period in which traditional feuds among noble clans, often, as Montaigne will write, under the pretext of religion, intensify. Moreover, at the siege of Sancerre in 1573, Delary himself had been the witness to the practice of survivor cannibalism. And even within feuds in Europe, the violence could be extreme and lead not, if to cannibalism itself, to the ritual dismemberment of the victim's body, and in some cases, the feeding of parts of the bodies to animals, as Ed Muir in his really wonderful book, Mad Blood Stirring, has shown was the case in the Friuli in the early 16th century. And it's a practice to which, by the way, Montaigne himself appears to allude in his essay. The reading of cannibalism as a central element in a feud was not original, however, with either Tevez or de Lery. Other 16th century authors had offered a similar account, and I'm going to skip over a little bit here, but some of the Portuguese missionaries investigating the cultures of the New World in the earlier part of the 16th century had been witness to similar scenes and had offered a similar analysis, also placing a great deal of emphasis on the dynamic of the vendetta, the feud, or revenge, or vengeance, as the trigger for this violence. And Montaigne will pick up on this idea as well. Like Tevez and de Lery, he places the act of cannibalism within the broader context of the feud, and he understands cannibalism as an act of vengeance. He even writes, "They do not do this as something for nourishment, as the Scythians anciently did, but as a representation of extreme revenge." Montaigne also borrows directly from de Lery's moral arguments. I began my remarks tonight with a famous passage of Montaigne on essay in which he asked us not to be too quick to judge the barbarism of others. Tevez, it turns out, had judged the cannibals harshly. Tevez had written, "This rabble eats human flesh in an ordinary way, just as we eat mutton, and they take even greater pleasure in so doing. And you can be sure that it is not easy to free a man who has fallen into their hands on account of the appetite that they have to eat him. There are no beasts in the deserts of Africa or in cruel Arabia who hunger so ardently after human blood as these people who are even more savage than brutal." So there Tevez is being extremely inclined to reduce the foreigner to the cannibal barbarian. De Lery makes the opposite argument. "I could add similar arguments, similar examples of the cruelty of the savages towards their enemies, but it seems to me," De Lery writes in his account, "what I have said is enough to horrify you." And then he invites his readers to consider the savagery of Europe. He writes, "Furthermore, if it comes to the brutal action of really, as one says, chewing and devouring human flesh, over here, who, even among those who bear the name of Christians, both in Italy and elsewhere, who, not content with having cruelly put to death their enemies, have been unable to shake their bloodthirst except by eating their livers and their hearts, and without going any further, during the bloody tragedy that began in Paris on the 24th of August, 1572, among other acts horrible to recount, which were perpetrated at that time throughout the kingdom, the fat of human bodies, was it not publicly sold to the highest bidder? The livers, hearts, and other parts of these bodies, were they not eaten by the furious murderers of whom hell itself stands in horror?" And he goes on to list a number of accounts of the barbarity of the Europeans, including the alleged cannibalism of the Europeans at this time. In fact, in the 1611 edition of his text, he adds an entire chapter of the barbarity of Europeans to his account. Montaigne draws on this clearly in his argument. Montaigne's argument that we too are barbarians, we Europeans too are barbarians, is part of a larger discourse that's taking place in a Europe suddenly struck by its own barbarism in the 16th century. But he also develops what I would call an anthropological argument. He's concerned not only with describing a particular people's, not only with an ethnography, but also and above all with a general understanding of the human condition and in teasing out what diverse cultures, despite their diversity, have in common. And here he develops, in his essays, a very famous distinction that will resonate in the Enlightenment, particularly with writers like Rousseau, that has antecedents in classical literature and writers like Virgil, the distinction between culture and nature. And he will argue that nature, the natural Brazilian, the person in nature, is in fact purer and more innocent than one who is brought into culture. And that therefore, in their language, I'm trying to skip ahead here because I'm running out of time, but in their language, the very words that we have that signify lying, treachery, dissimulation, avarice, envy, pardon, are never heard of. And then he writes in a very poignant sentence, "I find there is nothing barbarous and savage in this nation, by anything I can gather, excepting that everyone gives the title of barbarism to everything that is not in use in his own country. That everyone gives the title of barbarism to things that are not in use in his own country." And so Montaigne will use this argument to underscore in a variety of ways a common humanity. And he will even point to examples of cannibalism in his own society through an oblique reference to medicinal cannibalism in Europe, which was practiced among the Paracelsians in the 16th, 17th, and 18th century, where there was a medical use of carcasses, particularly of mummies, noting that, quote, and I wonder if this is a deliberate pun on Montaigne's part, "physicians make no bones of employing it to all sorts of use, either to apply it outwardly or to give it inwardly for the health of the patient. But there never was any opinion so irregular as to excuse treachery, disloyalty, tyranny, and cruelty, which are our familiar vices." So we allow ourselves to eat mummies, and yet we don't recognize that this could be a practice that others might see as cannibalistic. Now, it would not be Montaigne's account of cannibalism that would prevail. Another narrative, one that stressed the barbarism of the cannibals of the New World, would, by a remarkable coincidence, it's another first-hand account of the Tupinamba, written almost contemporaneously with the French accounts of Delaby and Tevet. This was the best-selling account of the German adventurer Hans Staden, Die wahrhaftige Historie und Beschreibung einer Landschaft der wilden, nackten, grimmigen Menschfresserleuten in der neuen Weltamerika gelegen, or the true history and description of savage, naked, and man-eating peoples located in the New World. This account by Hanstaden, published in Marburg in 1557, would become a bestseller. And Staden, who had been a gunner, a soldier in the Small Catholic League War in the 1540s, was a young man interested in adventure, had traveled to Lisbon, had hoped to go to the Indies. Gets to the Indies, the fleet gets to Lisbon, the fleet for the Indies has already left, he takes a boat rather to Brazil. He's back from Brazil and he returns to Brazil and becomes a gunner in a fort among the Portuguese in Brazil. 2 years later, he's captured by the Tupinamba. He's stripped naked. He's told that they are going to eat him. He's dragged off. He's almost certain he's going to die, but he's picked up the local language and he's able, so he claims, and it's far after this true story, he's able to convince them that he has certain shamanistic powers, and they do not consume him. So he survives, and a few years later, he comes back to first France and then to Germany, where, with the assistance of another educated man, he writes his best-selling True History. This history becomes illustrated, and let's go back to this illustration. And these illustrations become very important visual representations of cannibalism in the late 16th century. But they become even more important at the very end of the 16th century and the early 17th century in Theodore de Vries' multi-volume collection of narratives about voyages to the New World. And you'll see that de Vries' image is more classicizing, more detailed, and de Vries' images will play a major role in fixing the image of the horrors of cannibalism in the New World, just at the point when English and Dutch overseas power is being projected, and they will be consumed, as it were, by the English and the Dutch. So I want to just end, and I'm going to end in just a few minutes, so you can catch the vaporetto if you need to. I want to end with just the conclusion of the essay. At the end of his essay on cannibals, Montaigne recalls his own personal encounter with three Tupi in Rouen. In 1562, Montaigne had traveled there to join the young King Charles IX in his fort city, where several Brazilian natives were to meet the monarch. This was not the first occasion upon which native Brazilians had been brought back to France and presented to the king, but it's the first occasion in which we have a record of a conversation. We don't know what the words were that were exchanged with the king. We only know that, according to Montaigne, the king himself talked to them for a good while, and they were made to see our fashion, our pomp, and the form of a great city. But after the conversation with Charles ended, there was a general conversation between the Indians and the courtiers in attendance. Someone in the party, Montaigne does not say who, asked the Indians what of all the things that they had seen in Europe that they most admire. And concerning their response, Montaigne records the following. They said in the first place, they thought it very strange that so many tall, strong men with beards and well-armed should submit to obey a child. King Charles was 12 years old. And they did not rather choose out one amongst ourselves who was strong to command. Secondly, then Montaigne says, they have a way of speaking in their language to call men half of one another. Makes me think of Plato's Symposium. But men are half of one another. But they had observed that there were among us men rich and crammed up with all manner of commodities, while in the meantime, their halves were begging at their doors, lean and half starved with hunger and poverty. And they thought it strange that these poor halves were able to suffer so great an inequality and injustice, and that they did not take the others by the throats or set fire to their houses. Had Montaigne ended his account at this point, we would remember his essay on cannibals, perhaps best of all, as a stinging critique of the harsh inequalities of European society. And it was a remarkably hierarchical place. There were people living on chestnuts in Europe and people feasting on mutton. It was an extraordinary array of inequalities. But Montaigne chose rather to close with an anecdote that suggested that the Tupi had perhaps less moral high ground than their question had implied. Following this general discussion, Montaigne tells us, he had an individual conversation with one of the Tupi. I talked to one of them a great while, he writes, and asked him what advantage he reaped from the superiority he had amongst his own people, for he was a captain, and our mariners called him a king. He told me in response, his advantage was to march at the head of men in war. Demanding of him further how many men he had to follow him, he showed me a space of ground to signify as many as could march in such a compass, which might be 4,000 or 5,000 men. And putting the question to him whether or not his authority expired with the war, he told me it remained, and that when he went to visit the villages of his dependents, they cut him a path through the thick of their woods by which he might pass at his ease. And then in his closing sentence, Montaigne quips, all this does not sound very ill, but why should it be any different? For they wear no breeches. But what was the point of Montaigne's witticism here? Did he wish to remind us, his readers, that the Brazilians were naked savages? Possibly. But I also suspect that he saw little difference when all rulers are stripped naked between the exercise of power in the new world from the exercise of power in the old world. Throughout his writings, Montaigne's interest was, as is well known, la condition humaine, the human condition. And he was among the first moderns to reflect, and to reflect well, upon what we might now call the global human condition. Thank you.
If there is the discussion about the Eucharist,
yes.
It is something that you are eating. So
yes.
It is a person you are eating, basically. So maybe that the obsession with cannibalism has something to do with the discussion about devouring Christ. Could that be, or would you?
So the question is about whether or not the debates about the Eucharist
yes.
Come into play in debates about cannibalism. And it's a great question. In the 18th century, just to go quickly, VIULectures contributes the essay on cannibals, which is actually a sub-essay on carols, to the Encyclopedia. And in the cross-references to the essay on cannibals, there's an essay on the Eucharist. And VIULectures points out that Christians were accused of cannibalism by the pagans in the early centuries of Christianity. And so there's this association. There's a French scholar, brilliant French scholar, Frank Le Crignon, who works on this material. And he reads some of the language of De Lévy and some of the accounts of Bugagnon in Montbarbet as evidence that debates over the Eucharist and the eating of the body of Christ are playing a role in the anxieties about witnessing cannibalism in the new world. So, yes, I see that it's possible that in the 16th century, in these sort of anthropological texts, that there are such connections being made. But they're not particularly explicit. I haven't found a totally explicit argument. But certainly it's something that will come up very much so in the Enlightenment. And I think it's important to see that there is, in the ritual of Catholicism, an implicit cannibalism involved. And this is possibly one of the ways in which people flatten out the differences between the cultures.
This is a question about your method. Chomsky uses a similar kind of...
I'm sorry?
Chomsky. You know,
yes.
Chomsky uses
yes.
a similar halfway. He'll start with a story that was false.
Yes.
Even in physical or social sciences, and then talks about the terrible consequences as you did.
Yeah.
And then he'll say we're still doing the same thing today.
Yes.
You didn't go that far, so I was wondering if you're
well, so the question is, are we doing the same thing today? Which I think is an extraordinarily powerful question. And to be honest, it was difficult to show the image of the massacre of the Saint Bartholomew's in Paris. Only a few days after the massacre in Paris, on Friday the 13th, 2015. And I thought, and I think all of us think about this, that, I mean, one of the great problems that we face in the 21st century, I believe, and I think most of us would see this, is that we had narratives of secularization, and we thought for the future, we thought this in the 60s and 70s, would be largely secular. And we've entered into a world which has a lot of religious tension and religious violence. And so there are certainly parallels. And the word, I heard a speech this morning, or noon really, by François Hollande, and he used the word barbarity several times. So we have to be careful about what we mean by the word barbarism. And we have to be careful where the barbarism lies. And that, I think, is the recurring value of an essay like Montaigne's essay on cannibals, is that it invites us to reflect on our own human condition, our own capacity for inflicting harm. It doesn't guide us politically about what to do, but it calls us to be cautious about making these other observations. And the early modern world is much more I believe the early modern world, among certain intellectuals at least, and not only intellectuals, but mariners and sailors and soldiers and conquistadores and missionaries, pilgrims, a lot of people are moving around. There are a lot of connectivities established, not only within Europe, but with other parts of Eurasia and Africa in the early modern period. And those movements put people in contact with other cultures. And so it's already quite global after 1500. Things are already quite global. And that raises questions of how do we interact with other people and other cultures. And this is a very important problem for the intellectual life of Europeans in this period, for sure.
That was great. I enjoyed it. And I was wondering about a couple things. One is about national traditions and national settings and how much difference they're making in the way people are understanding these issues. So Montaigne being in France, and you talk about the French religious wars, but then Las Casas is debating Sepúlveda roughly the same time in Spain. And
yes,
you have these different imperial colonizing empires in the making were often at odds with one another, and these very different settings within which these authors are trying to make sense of the new world encounter.
Yes.
But a question I have is just how much are people in debate across geographical and national borders? And then my second question, which is probably related to that, is how much, I mean, use the word culture if you're like trying to understand question of trying to make sense of difference, but you know, I was always taught that the culture concept, as we understand it, doesn't really get embedded until the 1800s. The idea that you have your way of doing things over here, and we have our way of doing things over there. I know Las Casas, for example, right, he's recognizing that people in the New World do things in different ways, but there's still this kind of theological hierarchy.
Yes.
Of the barbarians are the pagans, and the Christians are the Christians, and the Indians are good for him because they haven't had a chance to convert.
Yes.
Whereas the Moors in North Africa are bad because they've been exposed to Christianity and haven't chosen. So he's not operating on a kind of idea of, you know, certainly of respect,
right,
for the culture.
Right.
I'm sure you're not saying Montaigne is doing that otherwise, but I guess that would matter. So like these national issues and how they're framing, and then also like what kind of understanding of difference.
Those are both great questions, and I want to address the national question more quickly, because the second question I think is something I'd like to try to develop a bit. One of the remarkable things to me about the 16th and 17th centuries is that it is true that there are a lot of, I think the national context is important. Las Casas of the Bay takes place before the king, it obviously has imperial residences. Montaigne has contacts with the monarchy in France. However, a lot of these texts circulate throughout all of Europe, and Montaigne himself probably makes use of at least Gomorrah's account of the New Worlds. And Montaigne has connections through his mother to Iberia, and of course he had great intellectual interest in many things that were going on in Spain. So I think the nationalism's question is not something I've really thought about in this particular context. I think it would be worth thinking about. I do think that you see an inflection in the way cannibals are portrayed in the 17th century as the British Empire is going. It's quite different from what one is seeing in the Spanish Empire. But the question of culture and what that is, I think is really worth digging into. And I just have two thoughts about it, and they were a part of the paper that I really had to skip over. One is, and this I'm picking up on an essay by Carlo Ginzburg on the same part of Montaigne's essays, is that Montaigne is a humanist. His Latin is absolutely impeccable. You probably all know that he's the last European for whom Latin was his first language. His father hired a German tutor who spoke no French to come to France to teach Montaigne as a baby Latin. So by the time Montaigne was 6 years old, his Latin was terrifically advanced. When he went to school, his professors, his teachers were embarrassed. Their Latin was not as good as this young 6 year old boy. Montaigne also had many of the attributes of a kind of humanist method of reading ancient texts. He believed that no word could make sense outside of the context, not necessarily cultural context, but the context in which it was spoken. We all know that as we struggle with other languages, right? That a dictionary is not enough. You have to kind of get a feel for something to understand what someone is saying. Montaigne had that with ancient texts in the ancient world. We see in Montaigne an interesting shift where he's taking some of the skills of trying to interpret another language and projecting it horizontally to another society at the same time that he's writing. So one of the interesting questions is, and this would be very interesting, I think, for the history of ethnography, is how this humanist thinking, humanist methods, how did they get deployed in the 16th and 17th century as people encounter other cultures? The other aspect of this that I think is very interesting is that I think you're absolutely right about the hierarchy of Christianity. And I don't know much about the University of Salamancas, but I keep reading about the University of Salamancas because the most radical writers in Spain, like Las Casas, studied there. And they're deeply influenced by Thomas Aquinas' natural law theory. And in Thomas Aquinas' natural law theory, you have four laws: eternal, divine, human, and natural. What's really interesting is that natural law is, in general, but perhaps especially at the School of Salamancas, creates a framework. For Aquinas, it was Muslim. It was about Muslims, largely. How do we understand Muslim society? Well, they have marriages, they have ceremonies around childbirth, they have ceremonies around death, they have religious beliefs. This is all part of natural law. They don't need revelation to be fully human. And you see a similar kind of set of tools being drawn not from the humanist, but from the scholastics. And I think both of these sets of tools, while they don't elaborate a concept of culture in a modern anthropological sense, create a certain intellectual space where one can talk about difference. But I don't think to my knowledge, no one has really worked out how these tools are. I mean, Pagan has a bit in his Fall of Natural Man done this with natural law, but I don't think there's been an adequate working out of how this ethnographic imagination develops. But it's a really important, I think it's a really important question in European intellectual history because it lasts for so long. It really lasts up to the present. And it really takes off in the 16th century.
If you are really into this problem, some backstage of the historian's work, how did you come across the theme? Is this theme linked to your book, which you're writing here? And do you think this would be what an important role into the book? Where and why?
So the theme I have, for reasons I don't understand, I work primarily on Italian history, but I've been fascinated by Montaigne for years. And I've been reading him and thinking about him for a long time. But the other factor is I am trying to write a book, finish a book this year, and the book is a history of Europe in the 16th, 17th, and 18th centuries. And it is entitled, the first part of the title is Crossing the Pillars of Hercules. And it is not only about, but it is investigating to a large degree crossings, the whole idea of a crossing, of moving from one place to another and what it means to come back from another place and talk about that other place. And I'm finding this to be a thread in the Renaissance and the Reformation and the scientific revolution, if we can still call it that, Enlightenment, this extremely important and that it really, this consciousness of these crossings is extremely central to the way in which European thinkers, and I don't mean only university-educated people because everyone's thinking, and certainly a lot of people who are not educated in universities who've traveled as sailors or soldiers come back with similar kinds of arguments, that it does create this conflict among those who really believe that European civilization is the great civilization, and those who really believe that, in fact, Europe is not the great civilization, and that Europe has a sort of problematic relationship to the world. Montaigne, for example, is very impressed by China, and writes with awe about China. He's also impressed by Mexico, by Montezuma's world, and writes with awe about what he's heard and read in Cortes and other writers. A writer like Diabo in the 18th century will become one of the first explicitly anti-colonialist writers, and he's drawing on not simply ideas of the late 18th century, but he's also drawing on Montaigne and other writers of this earlier period. So I'm not claiming that the anti-colonialist or that the anti-imperialist views dominate, they don't, but they are present, and they're also present in a very interesting way within Europe. When I was in college, when we talked about Europe, we meant northwestern France and southeastern England. That was Europe. That was absolutely what Europe was. Italy wasn't even in Europe, much less Germany. I mean, Italy and Germany were seen as kind of exotic places. It was the Normans and the Anglo-Normans who were the Europeans. In the problem with much of European history, even today, is that what's meant by Europe is the Atlantic seaboard, from Portugal and Spain through Holland, France, and England. And that gets read on the map onto the rest of Europe. And I'm very interested in trying to take Europe as a whole, in thinking about Europe as a whole. And one of the fascinating arguments about Europe, if you begin to take it as a whole, is that beginning with the missionaries in the 16th century, there is a critique of Europe, which sees many parts of Europe itself as very much like the world that's being encountered in the Americas. That is, uneducated, undeveloped, unchristianized. And so their internal missionary efforts, and then later in the early modern period, their internal economic efforts to dislodge and create a greater amount of economic activity in Europe. So the idea of crossing is really central, and that's what has led me to think about this in relationship to Montaigne.
Why it was so important for representation of this new world, even until the Age of the Enlightenment?
So, I don't know the answer to the question. I think it's a very important question, why cannibalism becomes such a powerful element in the representation. I do think that it's impossible to divorce this from colonialism. That you know, without knowing the history of concepts of race and racism particularly well, I do think that one can make a general argument that cannibalism functions in the period from the 16th to the 18th century, much like race will begin to function in the 19th and 20th century. This kind of comes back to Richard's question, as a way of legitimating claims of superiority over other peoples. And that the horror of cannibalism, the implicit horror, becomes this mandate or this justification for colonialism. So I think that's part of what's going on. But it could be that it's also tapping into very deep anxieties about European barbarism itself within Europe. I mean, it's very interesting. I'm eager now to learn from you more about the T.A. Below painting that came to
sure
me. Very interesting to learn about that. Especially with the Riba in the background. That's fascinating.
One could add that there is a very long tradition going back to the Middle Ages to see in Asia all this kind of stuff Columbus found or thought to find in the Americas, and cannibalism is just one of them. So all of the great travelers of the late Middle Ages,
yes,
they all report about cannibalism.
Yes.
So it seems like the part of marvels of Asia is transferred to the Americas, like the Amazon,
yes,
is named like this because it is just one of the people of Asia. So
yeah.
Cannibalism is transferred too. So there's a very long tradition, and it seems,
yes,
that it is although you know more and more about the new continent and you get to know that it's not part of time, there's no Khan there and so on, you still have this image in Europe until the 18th century that there is, this is the continent of the marbles, which we thought before is part of Asia, and now it's its own continent.
I think the literature on marbles is fascinating, and I think this is, I mean, certainly it's powerful. You know, the fascinating, one of the fascinating aspects of Columbus's journal to me is that he says he's hearing this from the Arawaks. But of course, how does he hear from the Arawaks? He doesn't speak Taino. This is a very complicated issue. Even if he's working with an Arab translator who has some facility with languages, he's only hearing some things from the Arawaks. And he's getting gestures, and the translation has to be very bad. But the image, the images he provides of the dog-headed, floppy-eared, come out of the books of marbles and come ultimately out of Pliny. And so we have to imagine someone in a world for whom the marvelous shapes Columbus's own imagination. He's there, he doesn't know where he is, he thinks he knows where he is, and he uses the maps of his imagination to make sense of where he is. So the marvelous has a really powerful influence. One thing that's fascinating to me about Montaigne is, although he has a certain gift as a storyteller, he doesn't seem to have any close relationship to the literature of the marvelous. If he brings any of the marvelous into the essays, it's only to almost immediately discount it. So that's another kind of language. But these were very, I mean, very powerful representations throughout the early modern period.
So, I don't know if there is a relationship between cannibalism and all that happened after when it comes to meat consumption.
I read the most fascinating passage by a 16th century observer of the New World. I'm going to tell you this anecdote, and I'm embarrassed, I can't remember who the author was and what the text is, but I read this. So, it's a European missionary speaking to a cow. And he says to the cannibal, I cannot believe that you, a human being, would eat another human being. And the Native American responds to him, I am not now a human being, I'm a tiger. Which is fascinating. I think this is actually, I think this is maybe from the Saboon's Historia General. So it's fascinating because he's the person consuming, if this is true, or who knows if it's true, these are all mediated texts, is claiming that in the ritual act, he is no longer human, but he is an animal, which in a way means that in his ritual imagination, he's not consuming his own species, which maybe is an indirect link to that. But the world of the animals, I mean, we historians are beginning, and I've never done this, but we're beginning to study the history of animals, the representations of animals, the reality of animals in ways that we've never done before. It's an extremely important part, of course, of the Columbian Exchange and the introduction of diseases into the New World. And also, it's extremely important in the history of zoology and the knowledge of the fauna of the New World and how people began to interpret their traditional zoologies. In the old world, so it's a very, very, very rich and important subject. And the desire to understand botany and zoology are part of this set of crossings that take place in this period.
Cannibalism is quite associated to North Africa, not to Africa, especially Black Africa. When is the extension of cannibalism? Because so far we have spoken about
Yes.
So is it within your time range that there is also an extension to
It's also extended to Africa. Yeah. So I don't know as much about that by any means, but it's actually, it's fascinating because there are, there's some pieces I've looked at on not only European traditions of cannibalism, but also Japanese theories of cannibalism. And this comes back a bit to the whole question of marvels, because each culture interprets reports of cannibalism within its own cultural matrix. But certainly parts of Africa are seen as sites of cannibalism.
Slashing places.
Yes. And one of the most amazing things about some of this literature is you can find European commentators in the 18th century, for example, who are absolutely, while they're talking about the slave trade, are absolutely appalled at the culture and the barbarity of the Africans they're taking captives, but have no self-consciousness of their own barbarity. It's not reflexive always. Schiller is a good example of this, who makes this leap. And it's a reminder, as a historian, that we all work with our own blinders, right? That we may think we have figured out the world and are kind and understand the world, but it's possible that 100 years from now, people will look back and say, how could those people on San Siro have thought this way? You know, who knows what will happen? Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.